Good afternoon, everyone. It's my pleasure to introduce Jason Myers, who's a past chair of Py Tennessee. He's going to be speaking to you today about the SQLAlchemy Core. So let's give him a huge round of applause.
Hi. Whoa, very loud. As he said, my name is Jason Myers, and I'm going to share a little bit about SQLAlchemy Core with you today. This is a very high-level introduction, just to kind of get you acquainted with what it looks like. And then I'm going to show an example of some of the reasons why I really like SQLAlchemy Core. I thought I'd start by refreshing a little GIF here that shows what I really like about SQLAlchemy Core. It kind of gives me the power that I feel like this GIF has. It just kind of takes over everything. And what I like about it is it's got a ton of very useful functions, and you can pick and choose what you want. And a lot of that has to do with the way that it's structured. So the structure of SQLAlchemy Core is a bunch of layers. I meant to show you a nice enterprise-y diagram. There we go. The structure of SQLAlchemy Core is a bunch of layers. So we have the database, and that can be Postgres or Oracle or any number of things. On top of that sits the DB API, so like PsychoPGE or Python MySQL, something like that. And then right above that is where SQLAlchemy Core lives. So a lot of people are familiar with SQLAlchemy ORM. They use it with Flask or they use it with Pyramid or something like that. Core is what actually powers that, and it has some very unique properties that are available to you in the engine and in the SQL expression language that I want to share. I often compare it to Git. The ORM is kind of the porcelain, and the core part of SQLAlchemy is the plumbing. Some people like that analogy. So let's start first by talking about the differences between core and ORM. So the primary difference between the two is that the ORM is very domain model focused. A lot of people use it for domain-driven designs or to express things in Pythonic classes that actually create or represent the models that are in their database. And it's a fantastic tool for doing that, and it's very comparable to the Django ORM in that respect. However, core is a very schema-centric model. So we still treat everything like it's part of the database, right? We reference everything as a table. We reference everything as a column or a row. And our kind of connection between our database schema and our objects that we create is the metadata that ties the two together. And I'll share more about the metadata in just a second. Installing SQLAlchemy is super easy. Pip install SQLAlchemy. However, if you do use Flask or you do use Pyramid, there are specific installs for both of those to help you take advantage of request life cycles that match the sessions or the transactions to the actual request to the page, so that you don't have to worry about, okay, did I close the connection properly? It'll be built into the setup and teardown methods of the request. So let's look at initializing SQLAlchemy. So we're going to import it. And the first thing that we got to do, if you remember the chart at all, is at the bottom of that is the engine. That actually specifies how do I talk to my database and what language are we going to speak, right? We'll talk a little bit about dialects in a bit, but basically, we talk to Oracle different than we talk to Postgres, different than we talk to MySQL, and so on and so forth. This engine specifies the connection string and the language that we're going to speak. Once we've defined an engine, we're ready to start defining tables on top of it. So here I'm going to import all the common things that you're used to seeing, table, columns, integers, strings, and then metadata. So metadata, as I mentioned earlier, is the connection between this table structure that exists in the database and this Pythonic representation of it that we have in the SQL expression language. It literally kind of binds those two together to the engine and acts as the translation between the two. And it stores the things that the database needs to know but Python doesn't really care about and vice versa. So here what I'm doing is creating two very simple tables. The first one is a, excuse me, I have a frog in my throat. The first one is an actors table. Here I'm going to store the ID, the name, full name, and the body count. And then I'm going to store the roles that these actors performed in the films. So let's create the tables. This metadata create all does a couple of things. First of all, it binds the metadata to the engine. Then it looks at the database to see if the tables that are in our metadata are actually created or persisted into the database. If it's not, it's going to create them. If it finds them at all, it's going to assume they're correct, right? So if you make a modification or a change to that table code that I showed you earlier, and then you rerun this create all, it will not update that existing table. That's your responsibility, and actually the lady that's coming after me is going to share exactly how to do that using Alembic, I believe, which is a migration tool. So again, the metadata create all binds the two the engine to the metadata together and then creates any non-existing tables as they're currently defined in your application. So we can look at table objects. So this is just looking at a property on it. In particular, I wanted to demonstrate that you can access all the columns in this case by calling columns.items. It's a very simple way to see what's in my table, how is it set up, what properties does it have. And the other nice thing about this columns.items is that you can use this when you're making queries. So I can, just like these are elements in a list, sorry, I can also pull these out of a dictionary by ID, right? So I can do actors.columns.id or bracket ID, depending on how I'm calling it, and get anything that's stored back in that particular row's ID column from it. Opening a connection is very simple. It's just as simple as telling the engine to connect. And this actually creates a connection that you can create a bunch of transactions on. By default, SQLAlchemy will pull these connections together for you using its own internal pooler. But if you're talking to Postgres or something, you probably want to use something like PG Bouncer or something like that to pull them as well. Once we have the connection open, we're ready to actually start doing manipulating that data. So here's an example of a single insert. Here we're just calling actors.insert, so table, give me an insert statement, and then I'm specifying the values that I want. And these are just key value pairs or parameters that we're passing through. You can easily, you know, splat a dictionary or any number of things to throw that there. Once we've done that, we're going to tell it to execute that insert statement. That's what line two does. And then the third line returns me the primary key of the record that I just inserted. So here I'm inserting Graham Chapman, one of the actors in the Holy Grail, and he died three times in that movie, so added his body count as well. Or he played three dead people, I should say. And then it returns the result of the primary key back to me so that I can use it. So a lot of people ask, what does the SQL actually look like when I do that? And so that's what I'm showing here. We have, when I have that insert statement that I created earlier, I said actors.insert and stored it as INS. I have the ability to print that. And so what I'm doing is printing the string representation of that statement. And so you can see the insert into actors where the fields are listed there and then the parameterized values in the second part. The second line of this actually shows how I can see what got passed into the parameters. So I call the statement and I say, please compile the statement and tell me what parameters were actually going to be submitted as part of that. And so that's what the second part of this does. And you can see it creates a dictionary of parameters for me to look at there. A lot of times, though, we want to do bulk data inserts, and we want to move a lot of data into a table at a time. Maybe you're reading in a CSV for import or something like that, and you want to do it in chunks or in blocks, and this is a great way to do this. So here what I have is the same insert concept, except instead of it being a separate thing that we then save and then execute separately, here I'm putting it inside as the first parameter to the execute, and then I'm passing a list of parameters that match that insert statement, right? So just like I did the printed the string representation, it showed me what parameters it expected in the insert. I can then take those expected parameters, put them into a list of dictionaries, and then do a bulk update or a bulk insert that way. One kind of difference is, on an insert like this, you can't get the IDs of all the records that are insert without doing an additional query, but it will tell you how many rows were successfully inserted or updated, and that's what you're looking at here is results.rowCount. An update statement, again, actors.update, same concept. One difference here is obviously we are using a where clause to say, okay, how do I identify which record I actually want to update? So in this case, I want to find the actor name that's named Graham, and I want to change it from the long representation to the shorter representation that he uses in public. One other thing to note here, see how I did actors.c instead of actors.columns? Anytime you create a table in SQLAlchemy, you get a reflection of it, of all the columns in the C attribute as well. So here, instead of having to do actors.columns, you know, open bracket, name, I can just do actors.c.name and have direct access to that same attribute. Again, on an update, I get back the row count that was updated and executed the same way as the insert. And delete works the same way. You can call actors.delete embedded in the connection execute like I did here, or you can also create a separate statement. It again just returns the result row count. Now selecting is a little bit of a different animal. So unlike the others where we said actors.update or actors.insert or actors.delete, what we're actually going to do here is start with the select concept or with the select statement out of SQLAlchemy. Tell it what fields we actually want to select and then execute that query. So that's what the first two lines of this do. And then that's going to return me a result set, which is similar to results proxy in Django, but doesn't react quite the same way. So it allows me to do four row and results and then print out each of the rows. And you can see what I get back is a tuple that contains the fields that I asked for. So pretty straightforward. Ordering is also very similar. So we can just do dot order by, tell it what field we want it to order by, and then how we want it to order. And then notice one huge difference between this and a lot of other query tools that you'll see is my order by is table.column, the column name, and then how I want it sorted, right? So like descending, D-E-S-C, or ascending, A-S-C, will give me the names in whatever order I told it. And I can also limit queries and offset them by passing dot limit or dot offset in the number that I want to do. So in this case, I had three actors in the table. I asked it to give me back the first one of those, but offset by one, or give me back one of them offset by one, and that's exactly what it did. One other thing you might notice in the previous statements, and I'm going to roll back just a second to this ordering statement. In the previous statement, you might notice that when I executed the statement, I used the dot fetch all to go get the data. That will give me all the rows of the result set that would come back. And in this one in particular, I just said give me the first. I know I'm only going to get one record, so I just want to get that straight away and pull it straight back to me. I'm sorry, what was the question? Why are there two columns in the tuples? Because I pass it as a list in the original select query, it's going to return me a tuple object that represents any of the columns in that list. Even though there's only one, it's still going to create a tuple, so that empty part of the tuple is just there. It's actually a great question. All right. So now let's move into functions, so like counting, summing, those kind of things. So we've got to import the func operator from SQLAlchemy.sql. And once we've selected that, we can say func.count, func.sum, basically any of the SQL functions that are represented in the engine that you're using can be accessed this way. So here we're doing a simple select to count the number of actors that we have. And then when we execute the statement, unlike the other one, since I know that I'm just going to get back a single number, I'm not going to get back a tuple or a result proxy or any of those kind of things, I'm actually executing this as scalar. So con.execute, execute the statement.scalar. Scalar just says, give me the leftmost column of the first row, right? So in this case, it's only returning one thing. It's going to be a number. Might as well just get just that number and not get back a list or anything like that. I could easily call fetch all or first right there, but it would give me back the list. Here's an example of doing the same thing as sum. So what I have here is a select statement that counts the actors and then sums the number of times that they died in the Holy Grail and throughout their different roles, and then executes it and returns the first result. So I get a tuple representing the count of the actors and the number of times that they died. All right. Now, here's where it gets a little interesting. Joins are one of the first places where SQLAlchemy does something that I think is kind of amazing. Programming in general amazes me, so the fact that it works is amazing to me. I can say, kind of do this thing, I think that's what it wants, and it just goes, yes, okay. Joins are a great example of that. So here what I have is an old-fashioned kind of more SQL-focused join where I'm selecting everything from the actors table, everything from the rows table, and then give me where the actor ID and the role and the actor ID and the roles table match and just return that to me. So that's what I'm doing here. I'm executing that statement and then for each row just printing out the row that it returned. However, you don't have to do it that way. So in this statement where I'm showing off grouping, here I'm grabbing the name and the number of rows that they had, but see that select from right there? That lets me do something pretty amazing. So basically it says, get this information from the actors table and then join actors to roles. And to me, that's just mind-boggling. I know that it goes in and it says, hey, there's a foreign key relationship, and it puts them together. But the fact that I can just say dot join and not have to pay attention or worry about adding the extra statement to me is pretty amazing. And in this case, I'm also adding a dot group by to group by name. So here you can see this is how many roles Graham, John, and Terry had in the film. Filtering is another very expressive part of SQLAlchemy Core. So here I'm importing and or not, and the example I'm going to give is actually using and. What this is just a complex where clause. I want all three of those conditions to be true, so give me the match where the actor and role are together. That's just to link the two tables together. Give me the character name that starts like Fo, and give me the actor name that looks like Gra, and return those back to me. And so it gives me, hey, the only record that matched that was Graham, and he played the voice of God. Small role. And so on. So you have exposure to basically every part of SQLAlchemy through that. But that isn't where data just stops, right? It gets all kinds of weird, right? Sometimes you gotta do really strange things. And talking to the database and talking to the dialects exposes different things. Like I mentioned earlier, there are common dialects for most every database that are around there that are SQL-based. But sometimes you got to do something really strange. I work for a healthcare analytics company, and we rarely get state data from hospitals. And my guess is you know that they send that all in the same format, right? No, they don't. They send it to us in a million different forms, so much so that we actually have an amazing guy that we work with whose title is Data Wrangler. And to wrangle all this data, we use Amazon Redshift. And we had to write a custom dialect to teach SQLAlchemy how to talk to it. And you'd think that'd be a ridiculously complex thing, and it's not. The authors of SQLAlchemy are way smarter than I am and came up with a great way to enable that. So what if you had a statement that unloaded from select? So what this does in Amazon Redshift is it allows you to execute a statement, take all the results, and dump them out as a CSV streamed to you. That's a native feature of Amazon Redshift. We just needed a way to tell SQLAlchemy to go do it. And so this part is just kind of set up to get, you know, our bucket and all our AWS tip together. But however, this section here, the visit unload from select, you can actually see the query there where we replace the pieces as they come through. So you can see it's very easy to extend this, right? I literally wrote the SQL string I want sent to Redshift, told it what parameters I want to pull out or change or which parameters I want to be dynamic, and then that was it. It would then, from then on, allow me to call that. So how about an example of how do we use this, right? So here's an example of the statement. Basically, I want to unload a block of fields, join in a bucket and a file name using an access key. So here's an actual usage that we might use, for example. So here we're unloading a selection from a venue that's listed out there, and then getting that dumped to an S3 bucket automatically with the correct file name. All that from just that little bit of code that we had in our dialect example there, right? So this is the statement that would have actually issued. It would have resulted in SQL that looked like that, that was actually sent to the system. And that's an example of the power of the dialect system that's kind of built into to SQLAlchemy. But the thing we take the biggest advantage of at work, and the thing that I think is the most amazing piece of core versus ORM, is the dynamic table introspection. So this function here will let me give it an engine, which of course has an associated dialect, right, and a table name, and it will go out and read the database and give me a SQLAlchemy Core representation of that table, along with what it thinks the columns are like, what it thinks the properties are. If it can read what the primary key is, it'll give me that. If it can find what it thinks maybe a foreign key is, if your database defines that like Oracle, it'll give you an example of that. So all this function does is return to me a table object already associated with my metadata. That's the second parameter we're passing in there. Tells it to load all the attributes that it can and then load it against the engine that we supplied. How in the world that works is just beyond me. So one of the things that we have to do or that you have to be careful of is null columns can occasionally come up. Doesn't happen very often, but it does. it happened more previously, but they've done a lot of work to fix that. As you can imagine, introspecting tables is essentially magic as far as I'm concerned. And so they had to come up with a way to look at that data and deal with the nulls. What this is a real simple list comprehension that basically says if it's a null type, then add it to a list of unavailable fields. That lets us do things like check for those columns when we're actually performing the query and see if they're going to be an issue. So here's an example of a very long query chain before I get into how we can use the columns dynamically. So here what I have is a table that I've named T that I built from using my build table function earlier. So here you can see I'm looking at T.race, the race column, the factor column, which is the sex in this particular table, and then I'm summing the total value that's associated with that factor. So this is how many people by sex are in poverty in Nashville. So here you can see how I'm chaining the wares together, then chaining on a group by, then chaining on an order by. That's pretty much it. And I can also apply that same chaining capability to the conditional concept, right? So here, what I'm doing is I want to go out and get the discharge year, how many of them they were done, what zip code they were from, make sure they were in some years that we were doing, group them by that year, where the hospital name matches some provider we're already looking at. But then I want to say, okay, if total charges isn't available, right, then don't do this. But if it is, then add this additional column that's the sum of those total charges and label it as patient charges. Now, if you can think about that for a second, we actually have had a real smart coworker that worked with us build an entire kind of like query generation system around this concept, right? Because I can say, okay, if this field is present and it's this data type, have this kind of reaction, build this kind of statement, right? You can literally build a dynamic query builder out of that, which is an amazing thing. So if total charges is available, then we sum it and add it to our query result set. And then we can also conditionally do order bys and conditionally do group bys in that to further extend that the dynamicness of that query. And that's kind of a very high level, very quick overview of SQLAlchemy Core. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to take them. Oh, okay.
So when are you going to use core as opposed to the ORM?
Sure.
I mean, when do you decide?
So if it's not a model that I want to do a lot of transactional type things on, maybe it's something I want to do more reporting on, or maybe you just feel better using the SQL constructs, right? The SQL expression language feels very much like SQL, right? Just Pythonized a bit. If you're comfortable with that, maybe you're just doing read-only and you want some of the data warehousing functions, you want to be able to quickly and easily get to, say, some PL store procedure from Oracle. I mean, it's a great way to reach and do things that you wouldn't normally be able to do through the ORM piece, right? It's not model specific. So web apps, I tend to, you know, anything I'm using Flask or Pyramid, I tend to do that with the ORM. And if I want to talk to like data warehousing or something like that, or historical records, often I'll use SQLAlchemy Core for that.
Yep. Are there any ways that it caches data or it uses something like Memcache to leverage some other caching mechanisms?
It does. There are modules that it has to do things like that, and you can obviously take your result sets and push them into anything you want. The result sets are very pliable, so once you call that fetch all, you'll get a list of tuples. If you don't call that fetch all, you can pass that result set around everywhere and do a lot of stuff with it. Don't pickle it, Alex Gainer says no.
You mentioned that SQLAlchemy was basically layers on top of layers on top of layers. And I know that there's, for example, Alembic, which is another migration layer on top of SQLAlchemy. Mm-hmm. Are there other packages and layers and such that work with SQLAlchemy that you would recommend for various related topics?
So Alembic is the main thing. What I like about SQLAlchemy is that it returns just generic Python types. There's nothing weird about it. You don't get like proxy results and strange things that are difficult to deal with. They look like dictionaries, but maybe aren't. So I like the fact that it returns regular Python data that I can put into anything else. As far as things that I normally add to SQL, it's normally a dialect specific to what I'm doing. There are some people that have written things for like stored procedures that are out there to make them easier to access, but that's about all I ever use is Alembic and then the normal pieces.
And then the dreaded legacy database question. Are there any tools for reverse engineering things like views and converting to SQLAlchemy?
We actually, Brian, who's sitting here, has actually written a tool that we use that uses SQLAlchemy to look at a table, see what columns are in it, create a view statement, create a curated view, if you will, so that you can then operate it. I don't know if that kind of matches, but maybe you could talk afterwards.
For example, a case where you have a gazillion views in a legacy database that you'd like to convert to SQLAlchemy, which I guess involves parsing
what the views actually
what
do.
What the engine has access to. So.
Right. Well, you could always layer SQLAlchemy on top of those views, which seems like it would be miserable unless they're compiled in Oracle or something, or composite views, is that what they're called? Where they're fully populated already, it's not rerunning the query, basically. The other thing that you could do is you can use SQLAlchemy to find out what the statement that created the view was, or at least see the schema of the views. So you could take all of that into SQLAlchemy and then graph it, because there are tools that will let you take SQLAlchemy inspected tables and then graph them, so maybe that'll be helpful.
Great. Great talk. Thank you.
Thanks.
Hi. I do not have a question, just would like to add an answer for the question where you can use the SQLAlchemy core instead of ORM. So for example, I'm the author of the framework called Cubes, which is OLAP framework, and it generates SQL queries based on another kind of metadata, and it's heavily using the SQLAlchemy core. So as you mentioned, SQLAlchemy core can be used in a data warehouse and also creating data processing pipelines based on metadata. It's really nice and it's really easy to use. And you do not have to care about the dialect of the SQL. You just generate it using the SQLAlchemy. So thank you for the talk.
Well, one other neat thing, I didn't think about it. Database migration is another place where this is really nifty because you can read in one dialect and spit out another. It doesn't care. So you can introspect a table, pull it in as that table object, basically iterate all of those rows into another table object that is then written in a different dialect. That, to me, is an amazing thing. Thank you.